Okay, let me start now. It's a very simple, this lecture should be the most easiest lecture should be for you, because I'm going to talk about how the cell, how to go from cells to module, and how the performance of the cell can be varied or different under the different conditions, right? So when you are actually using the cells and module in reality, your performance will vary depending on the temperature, depending on the light, depending on the type of module and so on, and that is what we must discuss today. But this must be a very simple lecture for all of you, because we have discussed all this. So we look at the cell, different parameters, technologies, and how to connect them together. So one thing that we already discussed yesterday, that when you make a crystalline silicon ingot, it is circular in nature, and because putting circular cells in a module, you are going to use a lot of inactive area, and therefore you have to cut the solar cells from the side, and you get this kind of pseudo square. So the rounded corners, you should, whenever you see the rounded corner, you should understand that it is a monocrystalline silicon. While in the multicrystalline silicon, two identification: one is it is going to be a rectangle or square, perfect square. Second thing is you are going to get the different patches. Okay, you can see the different patches. So whenever you see the different patches, you will see that this is a polycrystalline or a multicrystalline silicon solar cell. Multicrystalline silicon is more common technology because your grains are very large. In polycrystalline, we refer to the grains of micrometer size. So this is one difference, and you should be able to see this in your modules. So solar cell, of course, when you put light, it gives the electrical output. So when there is no sunlight, no light, no electrical output. So many people ask, you know, what will happen in the moonlight? Okay, so if moonlight or any light source which has enough photons, which can excite electron hole pair, it is going to work. So even, for example, in cloudy condition, right, in the winter, in the monsoon season, there many part of the country will have the clouds. But when there are clouds, there is still you get 200, 300 watt per meter square of solar radiation. You can see that, you can measure that. And the 200 watt and to 200-100 watt per meter square is still very high intensity to generate 10-20% power from your solar cell. So yeah, that happens. Even the low intensity cloudy conditions is good enough to produce power. The solar cell IV parameter that we have seen already, but again I am just putting it. So there is a maximum power point where you get the power maximum, the corresponding parameter IM and VM. We have the current ISC and open circuit voltage VOC. But the important factor is how the output of the solar cell is going to vary at a different condition. So right, I told you that the performance or the cell efficiency or cell watt peak power, okay, peak power is given under standard test condition, okay. And what is standard test condition? I'm talking about 1000 watt per meter square. This 1000 watt per meter square should be corresponding to air mass 1.5 g. There should be a 25 degree centigrade. Okay, so these are the main parameters under which the efficiency of the cell, or under this condition, whatever wattage you get is actually referred as a watt peak. P refers to the peak. But we know that 1000 watt per meter square will not be there. I mean, there is hardly any time in the year when you will get the 1000 watt per meter square. Air mass 1.5 g can also change, and temperature is always going to be different. Okay, so all these parameters actually can be different, and particularly this parameter, okay, here and this parameter here are of more having more significance. Okay, so this temperature can be very different, and this radiation can be very different. So how does the cell performance will change as a function of this parameter? That is what we want to see. And today we are looking at the cell performance as a function of this parameter. But tomorrow, when we look at the module itself, okay, when we are going to look at the module and how to make the module and how does the module performance changes in the field, then this discussion will be useful and important. Okay, so we want to see that how the efficiency changes, if at all. How the amount of, what is the performance difference if the light falling is changes, what happens if the solar cell area changes, what happens if the angle of the light falling on the cell and module changes, what happens if the temperature changes. Okay, so these are the various parameters that can affect the output power of a cell and module. Efficiency, again simple, P out by P in. If you are actually using the current densities, or if your cell area is, you have certain cell area, so input power is always given in terms of density, watt per meter square, and therefore you have to multiply by the area. So therefore your output power is your input power, efficiency and area, okay. So remember, this is very simple, we can always use this. Other important thing, efficiency of the solar cell is fixed and it cannot be changed, okay. Once you have manufactured your solar cell, once it is manufactured, then you cannot change the efficiency, okay. Also, the many people make this mistake that when you say that light, many people say that when the light intensity changes, efficiency changes. That is not the case mostly, okay. So the efficiency is fixed, okay. Efficiency will be the same in the morning, okay, and in the afternoon and evening, okay. There may be slight difference, okay. So what happens in the morning and evening, your intensity is different, okay. Your P in is changing, P in can be lower or higher, okay. P in can be as low as, like, you know, 100 watt per meter square, or it can be as high as 1000 watt per meter square. So because your P in is changing, your P out is changing, okay. So in the morning and evening and afternoon, your output power is different. It is different because of your input power, it is not different because of your efficiency. So some people make this mistake that efficiency is low in the morning or efficiency is high in the afternoon. Not the case, it is the P in that is changing, and that as a result of that, the P out that is changing, okay. So P out is P in times efficiency times area, that does not change, area of the cell does not change, it is the P in that changes, and therefore your output power, okay. So keep that in mind. Now standard test condition is 1000 watt per meter square. Let us take a cell area of 100 centimeter square. So we will do the quick calculation. What calculation we will do? We will do this calculation. How does this parameter varies? So we are assuming that we are actually discussing with the cell area of 100 centimeter square. 100 centimeter square is not the standard cell area these days. People are making larger cells. So 12.5 by 12.5 millimeter square is the 12.5 by 12.5 centimeter square area is the cell which is commonly used in the industry, and many people are actually going for even bigger cell of 15 by 15 centimeter square. So 10 by 10, that is 100 centimeter square, is not the common area, but for the simplification of the calculation we have used it, okay. So conversion efficiency is given for the 1000 watt per meter square. So if your cell efficiency is 16%, if your cell efficiency is 16% and if your area is 100 centimeter square, your power output will be 1.6 watt peak, okay. Same thing, so I am talking about 1000 watt per meter square, my efficiency is 16% and my area is 100 centimeter square. If you convert this, you are going to get 1.6 watt, and because it is at the standard test condition, I have to use P here. Remember, when I am saying P, I am putting peak here, I am saying 1000 watt per meter square, as well as I am saying 25 degrees centigrade. So this is watt peak. So when you have 16% solar cell of 100 centimeter square, it will give 1.6 watt peak power. If you have 12% solar cell, it will give 1.2 watt peak power, assuming the cell temperature is fixed. So these are the standard test condition we are talking about, okay. So basically, when the efficiency is higher, your cell output is higher. What happens to the amount of light? Amount of light, as I said, will actually affect the output. Again, same, consider the 16% efficient cell, 100 centimeter square area of the cell. In two different condition, if your input is 1000 watt per meter square and if your temperature is constant, 25 degree centigrade, you will get 1.6 watt peak. Same solar cell efficiency, 16%, but your input is 600 watt per meter square, okay. Your intensity is lower, then actually as compared to this, this is 60%. So as compared to this, you will get a 60% lower output power, okay. So you will get 0.96 watt only. Remember, we are only talking about the variation in the light intensity, we are not talking about variation in temperature. Temperature has a separate effect in the reduction of the performance, that we will discuss later, okay. Fine. So when more light falls, more output you get, okay, and this relationship is almost linear, okay. That is why the solar cell that we have given you for your laboratory experiment, you must be getting a, you must got a small solar cell which we are using as a pyranometer, okay. So the light output power, so okay, this power, output power, because in this expression efficiency is fixed, area is fixed, okay. So therefore, P output is proportional to the input, P output is proportional to input. And we can actually put out the expression for the power, and we will find out that I output, the current output, is proportional to the P input, okay. And therefore, by measuring the current in the short circuit mode, mainly the short circuit mode, okay, SC, you can actually find out the power which is proportional to the current because of this relationship, okay. Therefore, you can use approximately a solar cell to measure the intensity of the light, okay, because your power output is proportional to the current. And mainly the power output is proportional to the power input density, and mainly the short circuit current is directly proportional because your voltage change is having different relationship, okay. And this is one example of how things will change. For example, I have taken a solar cell which is having 35 milliampere per centimeter square area, okay. This is the current density J, okay. I am talking about the current density. So what is the current? Typically, as I told you, the current density, short circuit current density for crystalline silicon solar cell is normally between 30 to 35 milliampere per centimeter square, okay. So that is normally what occurs. So once we know the current density for crystalline silicon technology, then any solar cell size, if you see, we can estimate how much current it will produce, okay. So right now we are considering a cell of 100 centimeter square area. So how much current it will produce? ISC. Now this is density and this is current. So let's say I am in the last case, I am taken example of 35 milliampere per centimeter square, your area is 100 centimeter square. So your current is going to be 35 milliampere into 100, so you will get about 3.5 ampere current, okay. Sometime what happens, you see the smaller solar cell areas, okay. For example, solar lanterns are the, actually the solar cell that you have with you have, I think, much smaller area. So the solar cell that you have with you is about having 25 centimeter, I think it is even less, but let me take example of 25 centimeter square. If this is your solar cell area, how much current you are expecting? Again, this is the current under all these parameters, is under standard test condition, okay, which is 1000 watt per meter square. So if your light is less, your current is going to be less. So 25 centimeter square into 25 centimeter square area into 35 milliampere, how much you will get? 25 into 35? 0.87 ampere, okay. So you are going to get about 0.87 ampere, okay. So your current output under standard test condition is directly proportional to the area, okay. What I also told you, your ISC is also proportional to the P in, that is another relationship we use. So under 1000 watt per meter square, you will get from this solar cell area, under 1000 watt per meter square, this solar cell of crystalline silicon 25 centimeter square having a current density of 35 milliampere per centimeter square will give 0.87 ampere, okay. Under 500 watt per meter square, how much current it will give? Same solar cell I am talking about, under 500 watt per meter, how much current it will give? Half of 0.87, okay. So it will become about 0.435 ampere, right. So in this way, if you know the current density, you can find out the current of a solar cell of any given technology, and using this kind of relationship, you can find out what will be the current at any other given input radiation as well. Clear? Okay, so here is the graph, different IV curve of a same solar cell under different condition. Okay, what are those conditions? 1000 watt per meter square, 800 watt per meter square, 600, 400, 200. In all this, we have assumed that temperature is constant. We are only discussing what will happen if the intensity of the light is changing, okay. So fine. So mainly the current is a linear function. You see here 200, 400, 600, 800, 1000 watt, your current almost increases linearly. So current is a linear function of the input power density or input light density. Look at the voltage here. What is happening to the open circuit voltage? What is happening to the open circuit voltage? Open circuit voltage is not changing linearly, Why it is not changing linearly? Because we know it. You know it? The open circuit voltage is KT by Q log of IL, what is IL? Light generated current divided by I 0 plus 1. So, IL is a linear function of Pn proportional to Pm. So, in a way VOC is a log function of input power density, right? In a way VOC is a log function of a input power density. So, current is a linear function, voltage is a log function. So, remember this. So, as we go from morning to evening or morning to afternoon to evening, your voltage of a module does not change significantly. Okay. As you go from morning condition of let us say 100 watt, 200 watt, 500 watt, 800 watt, 1000 watt per meter square, your voltage does not change significantly, but your current is going to change significantly. Okay. It is very simple fact, and I hope you all understand this. What about the area? I told you smaller area means smaller. So, once you know the current density of your technology, once you know your Pn efficiency, you can actually find out how much different solar cell area will produce different current. Okay, current density of crystalline silicon, by the way, is highest. Okay, and I will show you the some of the numbers maybe tomorrow. Current density of amorphous silicon technology, depending on the efficiency, will be like 10 milliampere, 12 milliampere per centimeter square. Current density of cadmium telluride and CIGS can be about 15-20 milliampere per centimeter square, a standard test condition, because the efficiencies are low. So, current density that you can get from silicon solar cell is the highest as of today. Okay, so, this is example. If the single solar cell of 100 centimeter square is giving you 3.5 amperes, is that what you calculated? Yes, that is what you calculated in the previous slide. Okay. So, it will give about 3.5 amperes, but if you take half of the solar cell, you get 1.75 ampere because your area is higher. So, okay, many times in the modules which are used for solar lanterns and a small power module have a, so what people do, people make a big solar cell and they cut into smaller pieces, so that your current can be lower, so that eventually the power output of a module will be lower if you want a lower wattage module. Okay, what happens if the light falls in a different angle? So, that is the question of a light. That is a question of the sun tracking, right? We have discussed in the very first or second lecture that if you want your module to be always perpendicular to the sun rays, you want your module always to be perpendicular to the sun rays. So, if your light falls on some other angle, two things happen. First of all, the power density falling on the module at the same condition is different, right? So, if your module is perpendicular to the sun rays, if your module is perpendicular to sun rays, okay, this is L is the width, length of a module, and width can be anything. Then in this case, suppose your power density is x watt per meter square, and in the same case, if your module is lying flat on the ground, same angle incidence, theta here, theta also here, if that is the case, then the same power density is actually distributed to the longer distance. Okay. And because of that, the available power density to this same module area is now x cos theta, and higher the theta, the smaller is the theta, your power density will be, is it correct? Okay, so if it is perpendicular, you get the highest power. If you, if the angle is changing less than 90 degree, no, it is not correct. So, it should be sin theta, it should not be cos theta, it should be sin theta. Okay. So, this should be sin theta. So, smaller is the angle theta. Okay, or the light is coming perpendicular, you will have smaller and smaller power. Okay, so this angle, this should not be cos theta, should be sin theta. Or what also will happen, if your sun rays are coming at some other angle, your reflection will also increases. Okay, your reflection from the glass will also increases, and that is also the light that is getting inside the solar cell or inside the module from the glass into the solar cell will also reduce, and that will also reduce the power output. So, maximum electricity is possible when theta equal to 90, and therefore, as we discussed, the sun tracking is required. Okay, so these are the ways, and now we will discuss the effect of temperature, for example. So, the temperature also affects the power generated, and first of all, we are going to discuss why it affects the power generated. These are the various ways. Now, the short circuit current is given by this expression, or I total current is given by this expression for the diode. Okay. and we can bring the approximation. So people have done I0 can be represented by this, and this term here, first term here, the first term here is actually much higher than 1. So we can neglect this. So basically your short circuit current can be represented by this. Now we, when you take a derivative of this, what we want to see, how does the voltage and current changes as a function of time, right? So what we are interested in is how the DOC changes with the time, how the short circuit current changes with the time, or most importantly, how the power itself changes with the not time, it is temperature, okay. How the power, how the open circuit voltage, how the short circuit current, and how the fill factor changes with the temperature, okay. So in the earlier slide, we have looked at the performance of the cell and output as a function of light, but now we should look at how these parameters, open circuit voltage, short circuit current, fill factor, and peak power point changes as a function of temperature. So this is the diode equation, and we have approximately can be represented like this. And again, we don't have time to go into the detail, but if you look at, if you do the derivative, now change in the short circuit current as a function of temperature is very small, okay, and we'll come back to that again. But change in the open circuit voltage as a function of temperature is significant. So once you put the values here, we can actually get this. So open circuit voltage with respect to temperature for silicon, okay, here the parameter of silicon, the band voltage equivalent to band gap, that is 1.12 volt, VGO, it is a not electron, it is a volt, VOC about 0.6, gamma is 3, and if you put this this parameter here, you will get about 2.3 millivolt per degree centigrade, okay. So change in the open circuit voltage for crystalline silicon solar cell per degree centigrade rise in temperature is 2.3 millivolt, okay. So basically, as the temperature increases, there is a negative symbol, as the temperature increases, the open circuit voltage is decreases. And why it happens? Because of the, as we discuss again and again, because of the temperature, there is more generation of electron hole pair, intrinsic carrier concentration increases, the recombination increases, and you get the lower open circuit voltage, okay. Now so because of this, now if you are, how to calculate the new open circuit voltage? So open circuit voltage of a cell at a temperature T is equal to open circuit voltage of a cell at standard test condition minus, there is going to be voltage drop. How much voltage drop? 2.3 millivolt per degree centigrade, and therefore you should multiply by the change in the temperature as compared to standard test condition, okay. Change in the temperature as compared to standard test condition, okay. So suppose you have solar cell which is having VOC of 0.6 volt, okay, at 25 degree centigrade. Now in the new condition, your temperature has become 50 degree centigrade. How much is the voltage at 56 degrees? So your VOC at 50 degree centigrade is equal to 0.6 under standard test condition minus 2.3 millivolt per degree centigrade. And how much is the temperature difference? Now new temperature condition is 50, but my earlier cell characterized at 25 degree standard test condition, right. So delta T is actually 25, 50 is the new temperature condition, and my old standard test condition is 25 degree. So this is what you get. So you get 0.6 minus 2.3 millivolt into degree centigrade, degree centigrade will get cancelled, 25. So how much you get? So 0.6 minus 0.6 minus, so 0.6, 2.3, you multiply by 25, you get the difference. So roughly it will come about 0.54. How much is 2.3 millivolt into 25? 0.057 roughly, okay. So you get about some 0.54 something. So this is your new open circuit voltage. So because the temperature has increased, your open circuit voltage has decreased, you can do this calculation. And this is very important to do this for a different technology. So you will find that this 2.3 millivolt per degree centigrade, this is for silicon, okay, this is for silicon, and this number will be different for different technologies. So this will be different for different technology. I will show you tomorrow for the cadmium telluride and other. So the short circuit current also changes, actually increases, you can see the positive sign here, but the increase is very, very small. In terms of percentage, it will be 0.06%. Okay, why the short circuit current increases? Because the band gap decreases as a function of temperature. Okay, the band gap decreases as a function of temperature. So as the temperature is increasing, your B band gap decreases, and because of that, what will happen? Because of the lower band gap, more and more photon will have enough energy to excite. So your ISC will increase. So that is what is shown here. And what happened as the temperature increases? I am talking about the current here, and I am talking about the voltage here. As the temperature increases, your I0 increases, and because of that, your VOC decreases. Okay. Now, similarly, you can actually get the other parameters. Your fill factor, look at the minus sign here. So your actually fill factor decreases as the temperature increases, and your peak power will also decrease. So here we are interested in the what happens to the numbers. So these numbers are very small, but look at the percentage. So your fill factor decrease is about 0.15% per degree centigrade. Percent of what? Percent of standard test condition. Similarly, standard test condition. Similarly, your peak power decreases by 0.004 to 0.005, which is about 0.4 to 0.5% per degree centigrade rise in temperature. Okay. So these numbers are important, and you should remember. So main thing is your peak power. Change in your peak power with respect to temperature is minus 0.4 to 0.5% per degree centigrade. Percentage of what? Percentage of watt peak at STC, standard test condition. So as compared to standard test condition, your percentage of power decreases as the temperature increases, and this you can do as one of the tutorial. You know, if your if your watt peak power of a let's say cell is we have calculated let's say 1.5 watt under at STC condition, what will be the output power at 50 degree centigrade? So that you can calculate. So percentage of the peak power. Okay, this calculation you can do. So that is what, as the temperature increases, open circuit voltage decreases. That you can see yearly the change because of the increase in temperature. The current increases slightly, okay, but voltage decreases significantly. So the main result of increase in the output, increase in temperature is the decrease in the output power. The various parameters that you can see here, the efficiency, the multi-junction solar cell efficiency is very high. What are the other efficiency of commercial modules? They can see amorphous silicon is 6 to 9%, 8 to 11% for cadmium telluride and CIGS. These are the parameters that you can get. The typical voltages and current, just look at it carefully of various technology. Okay, so the output current for monocrystalline can be very high, for polycrystalline it will be lower. Fill factor is about 70 70 80. Look at the amorphous silicon, the current density is 8 to 15 milliampere per centimeter square. Cadmium telluride 15 to 25 milliampere per centimeter square. These are the current densities, but the voltages can be higher than the crystalline silicon. Okay, the crystalline silicon voltage is 0.5 to 0.6, but in amorphous silicon, cadmium telluride and gallium arsenide, why the voltage is higher? Because of the higher band gap. Okay, higher band gap results in a higher open circuit voltage. So that is why you can see the higher voltages here. Fill factors are lower because conductivity is less, resistive losses are higher. So as compared to crystalline silicon, the fill factor of thin film modules are lower because of the higher resistive losses that happens. Okay, fine. I'll stop here. That the next thing is about the module, and we'll discuss about the module. So this is in this summary, what I have discussed is how the performance of the solar cell will be different as a result of the change in area, as a result of the temperature, as a result of the light falling on it, as a result of the tilt, and so on. So the various parameters, and what are the various parameters of the different technology. So in thin film technology, because of the higher band gap, your current densities are lower, but your open circuit voltage is higher. Typically, thin film technology has a lower fill factor because of the higher resistive losses. And how much is the percentage change in the various parameters? So the open circuit voltage of crystalline silicon changes by 2.3 millivolt per degree centigrade. The current changes by a very small 0.1 portion 0.05% per degree centigrade rise in temperature. The important thing is the peak power decreases by almost 0.4 to 0.5% of the peak power every degree centigrade rise in temperature. So, these are the very important parameters, and it affects the performance of the device, performance of the solar cell in the real life conditions. And it is very important for us to know how does a given cell and a module perform in the real life conditions. Okay, right now I will go to, so there is a time for question answer. Okay, Gandhinagar.
So my question is, if we don't keep PCO layer at the backside, then what will happen?
If you do not use TCO layer at the backside, what will happen? Actually, the backside layer, if your light is coming from the top, your backside layer can be, the question is, if you don't use the TCO layer at the backside, what will happen? So, if I have my substrate, okay, and if I have, this is my absorber, and the top is TCO, because light is coming from here, so this electrode has to be transparent, okay. This is one electrode and this is another electrode. Now, this electrode can be TCO, as I said earlier, or it can be metal also, right. So, typically people also use silver, silver here at the backside, very thin layer of silver aluminum you can use. So, you can use TCO or the metal. So, even normally you have to provide two metal contacts, right, at the one is the front, at one is at the back. So, some contact has to be there, so it can be TCO or it can be metal contact. But some metal contact, some contact has to be there, okay. There has to be two electrodes, front electrode and the back electrode.
If we use crystalline silicon, and the another option is thin film, so the only disadvantage of thin film or silicon cells are means lower current density or anything?
Well, sir, as compared to the thin film and crystalline silicon, the what you are saying, the only disadvantage of thin film is the lower current density. So, lower current density results in lower efficiency, okay. So, one of the main disadvantage of thin film technology is a lower efficiency, okay. So, now if I use a crystalline silicon module, it will give me efficiency of 14%, but if I use amorphous silicon module, it may give only efficiency of 7%. So, when your efficiency are lower, your for the same amount of power, you have to install double module, right. So, if I am putting 1 megawatt power plant, my module area for amorphous silicon will be much, much larger, and therefore, all the associated cost of the plant, that is, you have to put more modules, you have to make more connections, you have to use larger land area, all those costs increases because of the lower efficiency of thin film technology. So, that is one of the disadvantage that can happen. Also, the cost of the thin film technology is supposed to be very low as compared to crystalline silicon, but commercially that has not been observed. The cost of the thin film is not normally much lower than the crystalline silicon, and therefore, and also the performance of the thin film technology over a period of 25 years is not observed, okay. People have not installed thin film module in the field for 25 years, because the technology is new as compared to crystalline silicon. So, therefore, there are some doubts as compared to the thin film, and that is why the world market is mainly crystalline silicon. More than 80% of modules are crystalline silicon.
Why TCO is not used in crystalline wafer based technology for front contact instead of fingers?
Okay, well, question is, why TCO is not used in the as a front contact instead of metal fingers? As I told you that the front contact, the front side in the crystalline silicon solar cell is the emitter, okay, which is heavily doped n-type silicon, and heavily doped n-type silicon has higher conductivity as compared to TCO, right. So, if I put a TCO, first of all I am going to lose some light because the transparency of TCO is not 100%, and because my emitter, which is heavily doped and having higher conductivity than my TCO, can do the job better than TCO, okay. And therefore, in crystalline silicon solar cell, use of TCO will not provide you any benefit, and the finger arrangement, finger metal contact arrangement is the best arrangement that you can have. Okay, question from NIT Trichy.
Sir, which metals are used as a substrate, sir? Sir, and also what is the thickness of the substrate?
Substrates, like I told you earlier, normally the glass is used, and typically the thickness of the glass is about 3 millimeter, okay. Thickness of the glass is 3 millimeter. When we use metal foil, I am not sure about the thickness, but again the thickness will be less than a millimeter for a thin metal sheets.
Which type of metal, sir? Which metals we are using?
For the metal, thin metal, it is a stainless steel. For the metal sheet, we use stainless steel.
Sir, one more question, sir. For large area coating, which technology is involved, sir? For two meter.
For large area coating, people use PECVD, plasma enhanced chemical vapor deposition. Even for the silicon nitride, that conventionally people deposit as an anti-reflective coating in crystalline silicon solar cell, most of the technique use PECVD, plasma enhanced chemical vapor deposition. Jabalpur.
My question is that photo cell acts as a transducer, converts light energy into electrical energy. Similarly, in optical communication, we use photo detector. It also converts, it also does the same. To increase the sensitivity of in optical photo detector, heterojunction structure is used. So, does it happen in the solar cell also?
Yeah, in solar cell also, as I told you, heterojunctions are used. Actually, your cadmium telluride and cadmium sulfide, cadmium telluride is a junction with cadmium sulfide. So, cadmium telluride solar cells are actually heterojunction. Amorphous silicon cell structures are actually heterojunction. Your CIGS solar cells are heterojunction. So, yes, heterojunctions are used in solar cells also. Government College, Salem.
Sir, what are the factors that are affecting the lifetime of the PV?
What are the factors that affect the lifetime of the PV? You know, the so when PV modules are installed in the field, the temperature of the module keeps on changing, right? Every day, every night. Okay, in the daytime, the temperature of the cell will be very high because of the glass cover. In the night time, the temperature will go low. Okay, because of this temperature cycle, your metal semiconductor contact gets degrades, and therefore the fill factor decreases and the performance decreases also. Also, the anti-reflective coating, because of the ambient condition, though it is very well encapsulated, but there is a chance that your anti-reflective coating also degrades as the refractive index changes and etc. That will also result in decrease in performance. The encapsulant layer that is used in the module is some kind of polymer sheet, and that polymer, when exposed to the ultraviolet radiation in that ambient for a very long period, can also result in a degradation in performance. So, there are many parameters that can result in the degradation in the performance of a module over a period of lifetime. And how fast it degrades determines the lifetime. So, typically, I told you several times that in the lifetime of 25 years, 20% degradation is allowed. Okay? In the lifetime of 25 years, 20% degradation is allowed, which means after 25 year lifetime, your module will still perform 80% of its initial wattage. What does it mean? If your module is 100 watt in the beginning, after 25 years in standard test condition, it should still give you 80 watts.
Sir, is this because of the electron hole pair? After 25 years, will there be a decrease in electron hole pair created?
No, that decrease in electron hole pair creation can only occur when your light going inside is low. When your light going inside the cell is not low, and that low can happen because your polymer, which is used as encapsulant, can become darker. So, your light getting inside will become low, but once the light goes in, the generation is as same as the 25 years ago. So, semiconductor itself does not change. The other things which are associated with semiconductor, the metal contact, the encapsulant, the anti-reflective coating, those materials can change, but the semiconductor itself does not change. Amrita, Coimbatore.
Sir, I have one doubt. You have said in one place that crystalline silicon produce no output under low illumination condition when compared with the cadmium telluride. But in some other place, you have said the performance of the cadmium telluride is very low. So, I have a confusion. Can you please explain me?
So, did I say the output is low? The output of the crystalline, output of the thin film technology can be low under the low light condition, because the all thin film materials are high band gap material, and under the low light condition, the percentage of high energy photon decreases, right? That is what the curve I showed you. Under low light condition, the percentage of high energy photon decreases, and because the thin film modules are the high band gap material, their generation will decrease more as compared to the generation of a in crystalline silicon solar cell, and therefore performance of thin film will be lower in the low light condition as compared to crystalline silicon. But there are many other factors that comes into picture, the temperature, the spectral content, etc. will also become very important. So that is one parameter, but overall performance, which module will perform will depend on many other parameters.
So, good morning, sir. What is nanocrystalline or microcrystalline? What is the size of the grains?
In the nanocrystalline silicon, the size of the grains, you talk about 20, 30, 40, 50 nanometers. Okay. In microcrystalline, it is actually a bit of confusion. In microcrystalline, sometimes grains about 1 micrometer. So, 500 nanometer, 400 nanometer, 800 nanometer, that you will call as a microcrystalline. But nanocrystalline is typically less than 100 nanometer or so. Okay, MNIT Bhopal.
Sir, you, in the first lecture you told about TCO is a very, very important area of research. Could you throw some light on the areas, people are working on TCO?
Okay, so the TCO is very important because it can be used as a front contact and the back contact. It is also used as anti-reflective coating. The whole performance of, and TCO is also used as a light trapping, right? We, and the properties that we want TCO is, it has to be transparent, it has to be as transparent as possible, it has to be as conductive as possible, and deposition of TCO on the large area uniformly is also very important. So what, and also the TCO, once you deposit, after the TCO deposition, you are depositing your absorber layer, right? So in cadmium telluride, for example, you are depositing TCO and your absorber layer. Your absorber layer is deposition takes place at higher temperature. During that subsequent processing, after deposition of TCO, your TCO property should not get affected. Okay. So these are all the parameters which are important for the performance of the thin film technology, and TCO plays a very important role. Amal Jyoti College, Kerala.
Do we ever connect two types of PV cells in parallel, because the voltage output will be different, it will cause some intra current?
Yeah, do we ever connect, I mean, of course, crazy people can connect the two different kind of modules together, but normal people don't connect. But if we can match the current, voltage is always, when you are putting the modules in series, voltage is not a problem, right? So if you can connect one module of 6 volt, other module of 12 volt, absolutely no problem, because in series connection, voltage are just added up. But the current matching is a problem, right? So if your current is matched of the two different kind of modules, then I don't think there is an issue of connecting two modules in series. But normally people don't do it there. College of Engineering, Pune.
Sir, is it possible to use the buried contacts to reduce the shadow losses?
Yes, the main purpose of the buried contact solar cell that I shown yesterday, crystalline silicon technology, is actually to reduce the losses, okay? Because we want low resistance, and low resistance can be obtained if you use large amount of metal, but we do not want to increase the width of the metal contact, but we want to increase the height of the metal contact. So when we go for the buried contact structure, the width of the metal contact can be low and height can be high, so we can actually maintain the good conductivity of the metal contact, and therefore the buried contact technology will reduce the shadow losses, and that is the one of the advantage of buried contact solar cells. That is, in fact, one of the main advantage of buried contact solar cells.
With this TCO technology, can the absorption coefficient is improved by 100%?
Well, the TCO does not help to increase the absorption coefficient of your absorber material. Okay, your main active layers like cadmium telluride, amorphous silicon, CIGS, these are the main absorber layer, and this layer, absorption coefficient of this layer depends only on their own composition of the material, their own properties of the material. They do not depend on the TCO. Remember, TCO is only there to make a metal contact at the front and back, or to make a contact, sorry, at the front and back, and to provide you the anti-reflective property and the light trapping. It is not helping you, it is not helping the absorber to increase the absorption. But yeah, it helps to increase the light trapping, which will help to increase the absorption. Okay, fine. I think a lot of questions. Let me take some question on chat. Is it possible to use graphene as a transparent conductive material? I told you many times, people have asked this question. Yes, it is possible, but there is no, even there is not good enough research which can convince people that it is possible. So there are a lot of doubts whether it can be used or not. In principle, you may try to use it. does a decrease in temperature has the same effect as increase in the temperature? Yes, if you are going to decrease the temperature below 25 degree centigrade, then actually you are going to gain in terms of the open circuit voltage and the peak power. So, yes, decrease in the temperature has the same effect as increase in the temperature. So, when you decrease the temperature below 25 degree centigrade, your performance will be better as compared to the standard test condition performance, and if you are going to increase the temperature about 25 degree centigrade, your performance will be poorer as compared to the standard test condition performance. Okay, GSITS, can we concentrate the solar radiation in to increase the optical density? Yes, solar radiation can be concentrated, and there are technology like concentrator solar PV technology, in which you use optical means of concentrating the light, and so that once you concentrate more light, you can actually generate more power. But in order to concentrate, you require optics, you require sun tracking, you require solar cell, and so on. So there are a lot of other preparation that is required in order to make in order to concentrate the light and use it for the solar cell application. Coimbatore, is it? Yes.
Sir, I have one doubt.
Yes, go ahead.
Can you explain simply the light trapping procedure, sir?
Light trapping procedure, yes, it's very simple. If you are going to use light trapping means light once it is entered should not escape. Okay, so if you are having this, and if you are having rough surfaces, right, like this, and there absorber. So once light comes here, it may get reflected here, and from here it may get reflected back and get reflected back. So once light enters the solar cell, okay, once light enters the solar cell, it should not escape. Okay, it should not go here. That is not that we should try to minimize this. Similarly, once light goes back, it should not escape from here. So that also we should minimize. So this is called light trapping. Once the light enters the material, it should be reflected front and back within the layer, so that effective length that light is traveling within the semiconductor increases. Okay, light trapping is to increase the effective length that light travels within the semiconductor should be higher, and that is what is the light trapping. So escape of the light from the front side and escape of the light from the back side should be avoided, and that can happen if you get the condition of total internal reflection at the back side. Okay, if you get a condition of TIR or total internal reflection at the front side and back side, the light can completely be trapped. Okay, actually people have shown that the light can pass 4n square time, where n is a refractive index, so it comes to almost 50 times. Okay, so if you do the proper layer selection, the light can go front and back 50 times in the ideal possible condition, and that is what is referred as a, and this is what is light trapping. Okay, is that clear?
So the same principle is followed.
Yeah, the same principle is follows in the waveguide, for example, waveguide theory. We want to couple the light for the longer distances. You can actually use total internal reflection. So the question is how to create the condition of total internal reflection in a solar cell in a simpler way, so that you can replicate for the large solar cell in a low cost. Okay, thank you very much, all of you.